And we've designed that on purpose that way so that we can invite a whole panel to be able to answer a lot of the questions that you may have and that we have collected over the past couple of days from your group leaders, as well as other questions that they may have been posed to us. One of the things that we want to definitely bring up is the ability for us to potentially, answer and address some myths that we have heard of, or myths that you think, hey, is that actually true? Or how do I get on mailing list? How do I participate in certain events? Those are things that we're going to try to address in the next hour. And we're glad to have a great panel today, led by Dr. William Kay, the CEO of the Ziji Medical Foundation, as well as the main coordinator of TEMA in USA. He'll be joined with Brother Stephen Voon, who you've heard from earlier, who runs our mobile clinic division, as well as TC, main coordinator for our international outreach. We also will be joined by Dr. Stephen Deng, who is the chief medical officer of the Medical Foundation and also a key figure in TEMA US. Last but not least, we are also going to be joined by Dr. Peter Chen, who you heard from with the Healthy Community session. So hopefully in this panel, you'll be able to hear some of your questions being answered. If you have more questions, please let us know. We'll be happy to try to address those as soon as we can in this session. Now, if we still haven't been able to, don't worry, you can always contact us and we'll, through your group leaders, we'll be happy to address any or answer any questions you may have. So without further ado, let me pass this over to Dr. K, who will be leading this roundtable discussion. Dr. K?
Mm. After that.
So we're just waiting for them to activate their voice and as well as their cameras here. Looks like they're both on mute as well as the camera's not on. So we'll wait for them to prepare. And in the meantime, I see that Brother Stephen is already ready for questions. Brother Stephen, always great to hear you present. In the meantime, maybe is there anything you want to add firstly to start us off with? Maybe take a couple of minutes from a presentation.
Yeah, thank you. And I'm very grateful that this kind of convention that we have every year, we try to do the TEMA USA conventions to have bring every member of the whole United States to combine, bonding for our TEMA member for the US. Just like when we go to Taiwan, we know all the member there, like annually we meet each other once a year. So with this convention we have, we hopefully that we give all the TEMA members chapter bring home with some ideas how to develop their medical program and reach out more people that help can be helped through master hand and leg for her reaching out the poor.
Absolutely. I think a lot of these different aspects really help put everything together and form the entire picture of what it stands for and what it does. So, so now it looks like our panel is ready.
Hello, Kevin.
Hi,
Dr.
K. Yes, I think we can see you guys now.
Can we start now?
Yes, please go ahead. We have quite a bit of feedback from your line there, Dr. K. Is there a way to...
I'm very happy to invite five of the panelists over here. I think we are reaching to the end of the convention. I think everybody have learned a lot in regarding to TIMA, medical mission, international medical mission, a lot of topic. Although there are too many things for you to digest, but I believe you may have some question to ask. So I invite Dr. Stephen Deng, and Dr. Peter Chen, and Tishi, and also Stephen Wong, brother Stephen. I think they all accompany me to give answers to the question you raised. Before the convention, we collect a few questions already. If anybody still want to raise any question, please text over and we will pass on. I know the time's constraint, so we may not answer all the questions. We will try our best. So first question, what is the role of TIMA in Shiji? I will like to throw this question to Dr. Deng. Dr. Deng?
Looking at our organization structure, TIMA is a functional group. So it is a function. So when it comes to medical issues, TIMA becomes the main function. So it's a group of people who will try to perform these medical functions. So often in Shiji, we have missions, medical missions, and therefore TIMA is a group of people that will perform these missions. So it's a function. It's composed of many people. These people obviously will include doctors, the professionals. We also have Shiji volunteers and many other supporters. So while we are having the function, TIMA will form together to perform this medical function. And usually after the function is completed, the members will go into their belongings in the Shiji group. For example, we have commissioners, then they go fall back to 4-in-1 and be a Shiji commissioner. And doctors obviously will do their regular work as doctors. And for those that are not particularly part of Shiji, namely, for example, if you are not a Shiji commissioner, you can still belong to TIMA. So it's easier for us to communicate and be able to get you next time when we have another function or a mission.
So Dr. Chen, would you like to add a few?
Yeah, I want to add to you another point of view. Yeah, TIMA, as a matter of fact, is a volunteer organization. Even though the medical professional, including doctors, dentists, nurses, occupational nutritionists, they are main function in their scientific way, in the medical expert on that particular point. But a great, great majority of the work, no matter do the domestic or national outreach or international outreach, the volunteer, all aspects of the volunteer, they do 85% of the work. For the medical professional people, really very small part. But that's what we call a joint venture, for that, so that we can make the mission, what we want to accomplish, can be accomplished. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chen. You answer more than this question. So next question is related to this. So what is the intended delineation of TIMA USA and TIMA Medical Foundation USA? So Dr. Deng?
I mentioned about TIMA. TIMA is a group of people who wants to complete a medical mission. Now, Shiji Medical Foundation is a foundation. It will help to support TIMA from many aspects. For example, there will be potentially legal issues. There might be equipments needed. There might be certain planning, especially for the international medical missions, and many other things that will be requiring the support of Shiji Medical Foundation. So Shiji Medical Foundation is a foundation that deal with legal issues, generally speaking, and TIMA will be a group of people who would like to complete the medical missions that we Shiji has designs to do. So I think these are the general separation, although we are working together.
Yes, I think working together is very important. TIMA and the Shiji Medical Foundation is two sides of one coin. So that means TIMA is going to be responsible for volunteer part and Medical Foundation is responsible for administration part. And in order to make the medical mission complete. Okay, so
I want to add a few words. The Shiji TIMA is the one, the organization is not allowed to buy liability. Medical Foundation, it's a legal institute. It's a foundation. It had the right to buy, purchase the so-called liability insurance. Whenever TIMA work as a medical outreach, they need a medical liability to cover them. So that's a very, very close relation. Without them, I dare not to go out to do the charity.
Yeah, you're right. Shiji Medical Foundation is an official legal entity, and TIMA is not an official legal entity.
It's very important for us. A lot of people that try to make sure how things happen. Now, this is the, that take a lot of skill, take a lot of work. So we need logistic personnel to sign up in TIMA as well.
Thank you. Dr. Deng, would you like to add a few words?
I think the short-term answer would be anyone can join. If you are interested in part, be part of the medical mission, by all means, you are ready to be a TIMA member.
Yes, I think most important thing is TIMA accept professional volunteer and logistic volunteer. So it's not only medical professional can join TIMA, supporting volunteer can also join TIMA. That's very important. So next question is, I'm currently at Shiji Volunteer. Do I still need to register as a TIMA member? That's an easy question. Dr. Deng, would you like to answer?
I think it's an easy question, but it can be complicated. Short answer would be yes. The reason is TIMA is a function. It's a functional group. So being a Shiji member, you don't necessarily know about a TIMA activity. So being part of the TIMA, quote unquote TIMA member, it's easier for us to contact you when it comes to a medical mission, especially international medical mission. Quite often the local medical missions are organized by 4-in-1. Therefore, you will be aware of the local activity, but to trying to do more, it's always better to be part of the TIMA.
Great, thank you. And Stephen, I will not forget you. Do you want to add a few words on this question? Stephen Woon.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, because TIMA is a professional, belong to professional and non-professional. So the easy part is a professional is the doctors and non-professional can be SUGI members and a non-SUGI member be part of the non-professional section for TIMA. So in other words, for myself, I do have two applications with SUGI. One is SUGI as a SUGI volunteer and one is as a TIMA volunteer. So that's make the difference between some people are SUGI volunteer in 4-in-1, but not necessarily are TIMA member. They are logistic from 4-in-1. So they still can join TIMA to be TIMA volunteer. Thank you.
Yeah, I think Stephen gave a very good answer. As long as you're a SUGI volunteer and willing to join TIMA, work as either a medical professional volunteer or logistic volunteer, you can join TIMA. Okay. Next question. I am neither a Buddhist nor a vegetarian. Can I still join TIMA?
Yes. I myself is a Christian.
Okay.
I'm the one 99% vegetarian. I cannot say 100%. But I think go back to the second question about who can join the team? Practical everyone. We need all kind of level of people. So because the professional and non-professional, but very, very important, we had a concept. When you become the team member, we need a form to be filled out. A form, like for instance, non-medical professional, you don't have the license number. For the professional people, they need a DEA number, they need a license, and whether they had the recent had a felony or they had to report. So we keep in a file, usually Lillian is the one keep all the file, okay, so that we don't have to repeat again. That is a very, very important when it comes for the audit. And the second thing that when during the activity on the TIMA, either domestic or international, several things we should not do. Number one, don't try to do by yourself. Number two, don't talk about local politics. Number three, not encounter any business leader advertising. That is a no-no, okay? So you respect each other. So we need all professionals, we need 85% of workforce from 4-in-1 SUGI member. Whether they're joining the TIMA or not joining TIMA, doesn't matter. We need their help. And so local people, remember, we, even though we is a Buddhist organization, but I would say that 60% of members may not be Buddhism. And we serve 80% around the world people is not Buddhism. So the master already told us, around under the earth, under the sky, all are equal, no matter what kind of color you are, what kind of your mind it is, we try to serve everybody. Basically, we did not differentiate you. Who can see me? I can learn more of the Buddhist word than Christian word. But am I wrong? No, not necessary. Okay?
Thank you, Dr. Chen. You always answer more than people ask.
Yes. Very good. I tried to catch you. I'm 79. I didn't have a chance more.
You are very good. Okay. Okay. Next, we are going to change subject regarding to permanent clinics. Question one, can we start applying for FQHC look-like status even we do not have a clinic? Dr. Deng.
I think it's a little bit more difficult, even though I believe it's achievable, but the FQHC is a federal qualified health center. So technically speaking, it would be a lot easier to operate a health center. The more we look into FQHC, the more I've learned what FQHC or a federal qualified health center is trying to achieve. It's quite different from the typical medical missions that we are trying to do, even though we are serving the same population, namely the underserved group of people.
Thank you, Dr. Deng. I think it might be able to do, but it's difficult, just like Dr. Deng mentioned, because there are a lot of compliance issues because without any operation previous credibility, it's a little bit difficult. But once we are a FQHC look-like status, any place, as long as there is a need, we may be able to help any place who are willing to apply for FQHC look-like. So what is the next question? What is the benefit to be federal qualifying health centers look-like health center? Dr. Bain?
I thought I can have a simple answer, but this question is actually pretty tough. The true benefit of being at FQHC, I believe it is actually that we are able to select a group of people, patients, and take really good care of them. That's the easiest thing I can put it. The under federal qualified guidelines, it is quite complicated. And I think the main scope is trying to take care of a population, not one person, but a population. So the government will assign you a population. And under this population, HRSA, that is the sector that monitor us, will provide 18 different majors. And they are hoping that every federal qualified health center can perform very well on these 18 majors. So that is very, very different from the medical missions that we normally would do. So as I think about this question, it turns out I feel it's much, much more complicated than I can think of. But generally speaking, the true benefit is that we are able to take care of a population. And I guess the other way to look at it would be funding. If the federal is willing to award you a status, you don't have to worry about budget too much. They wanted to make sure you have enough to operate so you can sustain your operation and trying to achieve taking care of this group of population.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Dan. I think if we want to make this answer simple, it's just the reimbursement is good, but the requirement compliance also very tough. But because we want to be compliant, so we have to upgrade our operation so we can improve our operation. That's the benefit. Next, it's a long question. Is in regard to Chinese medicine. In this global conference, we are lack of Chinese medicine subject. And the question is, because we lack of the subject, so it's very difficult to invite Chinese medical professional to join this event. I apologize, we do not have enough. First, we do not have enough time to prepare the agenda and the subject we can include in the convention. And second, it's because we only have less than 50% of time, because more than 50% of time was supplied from the Taiwan headquarters. So it's difficult for us to add more agenda, including Chinese medicine. So Dr. Deng or Dr. Cheng, would you like to add a few words in regarding to this question?
Well, I'm not an acupuncturist, so I can't really speak for it, but generally speaking, treatments for COVID is not that easy, because it's not effectiveness that is the number one priority, but it's the safety. So in order, including vaccines, even if the vaccine does work, it is very difficult to prove that it is safe. especially when you administrate over millions and millions of people. So that will require very difficult and large scale trials. Now, using herbal treatments and some other more difficult to control type of treatments, imagine how difficult would it be to achieve the safety and allow the FDA to approve it. I think that's the hardest catch. And other than that, you know, we are all searching for a treatment for COVID. And I think probably the first thing that will be available will be the vaccines. And even with that, we are all struggling.
So Dr. Chen?
Yeah, I get some article or some personal correspondence from the Chinese, the traditional Chinese doctor, who indicated that he can completely cure COVID-19. I see the, did you publish an article? No, he wrote a letter to Donald Trump. And Donald Trump said, thank you very much. So he showed everybody a letter from the White House. But I think it could be a hoax, I do not know. But no question about it, no question about Chinese herb, traditional Chinese medicine had a very important role. Not only the improve our immunity system, improve your overall medical condition or physical condition. There's no question that that will help you alleviate the symptom or cut down the symptom of the COVID-19. Everybody knows about 100 cases of the COVID-19, almost 40% are completely asymptomatic. Another 40% may be very mild symptoms. Only less than 20% will be hospitalized, and maybe that 10% will be ICU. So if you do not treat it, 40% will get killed. Is that because your medication get killed? I will not say it's a placebo, but sometimes they are overstressed on how effective to cure. Nobody can cure. I'm a surgeon. I do a lot of surgery. I do a lot of cancer surgery, but I cannot tell you 100% cure your cancer surgery. It is impossible. I think they are sometimes overstated, but no question about it. Traditional Chinese medicine had its important role to be supported the current treatment. Right now, this morning, Fauci also mentioned that so far there no any vaccine will be available yet. Now, in mainland China have been third stage, but United States on the first stage. Now only one, four, five company had granted, but none want to go to the really last scale of the human third stage experiment. So that's up to now, we do not know when it could be. At this point, Fauci always say, only the four things you have to do. Put a mask on, stay away from the people. You don't have to go out, stay home, and make sure good ventilation. Yes. Wash your hand, et cetera, et cetera. That's it.
Okay.
I didn't have any answer whether it would be good or not. But really that we should include them to join sure. the TMA conference. Sure. That's my suggestion.
Sure. Thank you, Dr. Chen. I think next we have room to improve ourselves. Are there any additional questions, Monique? Any additional question coming in? Not yet?
Okay.
Okay. It's all right. We still have question continued. Next, I will go into categories of mobile clinic. The question is, which mobile service is the most needed in our experience, dental, vision or medical? Stephen, would you like to answer this question?
Sure. Actually, it all depends on what area and are we serving. Certain area may be vision, certain area will be dental, but these are two, vision dental are two under-insured population compared to medical because of Obama. That doesn't mean that certain area do not need medical in mobile. There is some demand on those. So it all depends on your area. In Fresno, for example, they have their more vision and dental. Some areas just dental, like New York, they are more practical to have vision compared to dental at this moment. for the service. It's all based on your local needs assessment.
Thank you, Stephen. And next will be which mobile service is easier to get a grant?
Most easy one, I think pretty much a lot of grant given to dental and vision for these two items. For medical wise, they do have, it depends on how, what is your program. If you have like for medical, you doing cancer prevention, those things, you can get grant. So all come down to what program you perform, present to get the grant. Custom make the program to so that you're easily to get the grant. So you need, each local area need to know your, every 2 years, your health department always give up an assessment report for the health. Read through that report and see what they need for your city. From there, create a program under using that guideline, you will get the grant. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. The next question is there a guideline developed to operate traditional Chinese medicines in our outreach service in USA? Stephen, do you know, do we have any guideline?
I think on the outreach side, we pretty much do the simple traditional medicine practice. We don't go those complicated one, like start issuing herbs, all those things. So we do basic acupunctures and also those simple massage thing. That's it. No more than that for our outreach.
Thank you, Stephen. I think for this, we certainly will ask traditional Chinese medicine's doctor to oversee this and also provide a guideline for us to follow. Next question is related to community outreaches. So question is, do you provide training for medical volunteers for community outreach? Do you issue certificate to the participants? I believe Stephen have mentioned in his talk. So Stephen, would you like to say a little bit detail in short about the answer?
Yes, we do have a training for medical volunteer, especially we start doing a standard protocol on how to train our volunteer so that our volunteer get be safe and also our patients safe and also avoid suji get sued. That's the key that why we want to train, make sure everyone follow the protocol at the SOP. And we do issue the certificate of participants for volunteer and training, especially help those student volunteer that after they finish volunteer with us, they apply for medical school or any other profession, they like to use that. And we keep, especially like, for example, we keep their certificate in place. After like, for example, 5 years later, they decided want to apply something, then they ask for certificate of participants, we can produce those things. So it's very important the local team keep a good record on those volunteer hour. Thank you. Am I going to continue the next question?
How about you? Do you want to answer this?
The answer is we do. Even when we are running medical missions, it is a profession. We do have SOPs created. Everyone shall follow. Without the training, we are not on the same page, and that potentially could generate some risk for the operation. So including professionals, by all means, we should all try to go through our general training. A lot of times we do the training right before the medical mission, just to go over basic issues, major issues. So training is very important.
Thank you. Next question is in related to healthy community. Question, can we have a common same platform to broadcast the webinar or use the same YouTube or Facebook account to store the health education video for people to enjoy watching it? So Dr. Peter Cheng, would you like
to answer this? Yes, that's what the we present my presentation is hoping we're looking for 2021 on. That is the because of the tele televised and we store all the talk and activity in the either video, and we had the we try to collect all the data and store in one same place. Everybody can review it when they have leisure time. And I find out that when I conducted the medical seminar talk in our health center, we could have the maximum of about 50 participants, of course, face-to-face. When I saw the TC had the video talking about how to take care of the medicine, et cetera, and his viewer is over 200, 300, and the exercise one had over 1,000, that is, I think the area we are going to go, because we can expand it, our audience basis. Of course, I fully favor to store in one place and make it categorize what kind of the topic in the A and what kind of topic B and C, et cetera, people can refer. Another thing I want to know, I really would like all the Zhiji 9 person, Qi 9 region can develop their own healthy community program. And I can be more than willing to go to help them out, you know, if they pay my plane ticket.
Okay, Peter, that's your commitment. In the future, I'm going to invite you to go to regional office to really enroll them in. Okay, that's good. Actually, this is our future goal. I think within a year or so, we are going to organize this and to make it happen. And for each regional office, you can develop your own program, inviting your own medical professional to give a talk in the seminar and broadcast to the whole United States. Next, the question is in related to international medical mission. Question, how do I get the international medical mission timetable, like schedules? Will Zhiji 4-in-1 or TMA USA inform me the schedule? Tishi.
Okay. Yeah, this is a very common asked question. Yes, we go through Zhiji channel. So yes, the 4-in-1 will, in general, we ask them to inform the members. However, it's so much easier that TIMA, we as a medical organization, we know what we need. We particularly target a certain population in the specific need of that particular mission. It's a lot easier with the direct contact. That's why we keep asking again and again, can you please sign up for TIMA for information so we can easier contact you and make our arrangement easier. We're trying to get the information ahead of time, and especially like this year, that we get the information much ahead of time compared to previous years. But hey, too late, okay, COVID-19, and we all, we have all the things planned ahead of time, and but we can't do anything. We cancel all of them. So yes, right. But yes, please do sign up, and so we can have both channel much easier to contact you and let you know.
Thank you, TC. Dr. Deng, would you like to add a few words?
Yeah, well, what TC has said is, I do agree, because it's a medical mission, and TIMA was born to support all medical missions, especially international, it gets much more complicated. Usually, Ciji Medical Foundation will step up and pick up the lead and go through the TIMA channel, invite health professionals to join, and of course, go through 4-in-1, since Ciji volunteers are also greatly needed for international missions.
Okay, one more example is, when we specifically need dentists, so it's not always easy for 4-in-1 to particularly pull out this population. But when we are a medical organization, the data is storage in a way that we can much easier to pick out the dentist and asking for help, for example. You know.
Thank you, DC. So this, we just complete the first round of questions. Before we get into the second round, I would like to get questions from the floor. So Kevin, do you have any question for us?
Yes, Dr. K, we actually have
we
quite
are
a number.
For your question.
Hi, Dr.
Before
K, we actually.
Go to the second round of questions.
Hi, Dr. K, can you hear me? Can you hear me over there? Hello?
Kevin?
Yes. Can you hear us?
Kevin, we cannot hear you.
I can hear you.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it
we
seems like Dr.
Hear
K
you, Kevin.
Cannot hear us over there. So we just gonna. So Dr. K, can you hear me now?
Can you guys hear Kevin?
Dr. K, can you hear us?
Okay, we have technical problem. I would suggest, Kevin, why don't you ride over? We are going to continue to second round, but don't worry if we did not have chance to answer your question, we are going to prepare the written answer and distribute to the registrars on this convention. Second round of question, this one is a little bit difficult. It's related to TIMA and medical mission, medical foundation. What is the delineation of branch office team or chapter and the branch office of medical missions function? So what is the difference or how do you divide the function in between? So Dr. Deng, would you like to try to answer this?
In the US alone, we have different regimes. We run different type of medical missions in different states. And therefore, most of these local medical missions can be conducted locally. So that if there are TIMA organized, of course, they will be able to perform these local medical missions. And I think that is generally okay. However, when it comes to something at the larger scale, for example, a typical example would be international, it is rather difficult to have just one regional TIMA to complete an international medical mission. And therefore, we will need some coordination. Therefore, a lot of times when we run a larger scale medical mission, we will involve TIMA from all regions.
Thank you, Dr. Deng. Stephen, would you like to add a few words on this question? Stephen?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So Basically, TIMA chapter and medical missions are two functions. They're bond as a, it's a bonding together. So a medical mission is really is a 实际 chapter mission, but is supported by TIMA member. That's how we put it, so that, that way everyone will be clear. TIMA member usually support event. So basically, it's a, let's say, friends, XYZ chapter have an outreach, they will invite their TIMA member to participate and also their community members to participate, that's all. So that's the difference between TIMA and TIMA and the local medical mission chapter.
Okay, I just want to give an example. For instance, in New York, in New York, Northeast region, they are developing a mobile clinic. A mobile clinic operation belongs to Medical Foundation because it is a formal medical entity to be in charge of the operation. So before they have a mobile vision van, they can operate by local TIMA chapters in New York. But after that, when they have a mobile vision clinic, they have to build a local medical foundation branch, which although still in charge by the executive directors in New York, but they are running the operation on behalf of medical foundation. So that's the difference from official term. So Stephen, do you agree with it?
Yes, that's a very good example that mobile is administrating by medical foundation, but the whole operation in New York is run by TIMA, New York, and their TIMA and their 4-in-1 volunteer. It's a very good example.
Okay, thank you, Stephen. Now I think we overcome the technical issue and Kevin can speak up and give us question. Kevin, please.
Yeah, Dr. K, can you hear me?
Yeah, very clear.
Oh, perfect, that is great. So there's actually quite a few questions, Dr. K. So we're gonna start with the first one here, which is a really interesting question regards to undocumented patients. And the question here is, they imagine undocumented patients is one that really requires their service or really needs what we can provide as a group. What are some of the ways that we can help this population?
Good question. And Dr. Dan, would you like to answer this question?
If this patient is near where we have medical missions, by all means, that person can attend our medical mission. One of the way of running medical missions by Ciji that is different from other organizations is we don't do it just once. We try to repeat, conduct multiple medical missions at the same place so that we can provide continuity care. So if the person is lucky enough to be within our clinics, by all means can always come by since we're open routinely. And so if that person somehow is very difficult to reach, one last hope will be our mobile. If it happens to be one of the mobile operating areas, we can always help the person. But if there is no means of getting into any of these events, that's a little bit more difficult. That is difficult. I don't have a solution for everyone, but we do our best in trying to reach out as we can.
Yes, I agree. Since 1993, when we had the first free clinic, we start to really helping the undocumented population. Until now, even we accept commercial insurance, Medicare, Medi-Cal, all different kind of insurance, but we're still taking care of them, undocumented people. And also when we do community outreach, we also take care of the undocumented people because we don't examine any immigrant document before we give any service. So there's no problem. We're still in the position to help those people. I think the only question is how will they be able to find us? That's the issue. And also how do we identify the need in certain areas we can do community outreach. So Dr. Chen, would you like to add a few words?
Yeah. Basically, the documentation for all the medical treatment, I think to me is necessary because you protect the patient, you protect yourself. You see, in case something's happened, and the, you can use the documentation to prove that we have advised the particular patient how to follow, how to refer, et cetera, et cetera. Especially the people needed to be referred to another institution or another test or another physician. You make sure that you document it. Now, throughout the year, I don't think we document adequately. Now, like Orange County, which we ran the outreach for about five years. Now we try to document it as much as I could. I'm the physician in charge, so every time I had to be there. All the referral document, I have to sign it. I take responsibility. So we had one particular nurse keep all the copy of the referral. So in case something happened, I can very quickly review the chart to see why I referred. Okay, like for instance, Dr. A said, see Mr. B, needed to be see x-ray. So he right now he requests that I had to go through me, so I signed it. So when I sign it, I take responsibility. So make sure the patient, the particular patient, Mr. B, had to go to that particular office. Now, if he did not go, nothing much you can do because here's the United States. He can do whatever he wants, but you document. To me, I think it's a very, very vital.
Thank you, Dr. Chen. Kevin, any other question?
Yes, thank you very much. So we have a few other questions as well, but I see a number of questions actually surrounding the topic of uniform training. And when I say uniform training, I meant sort of training across the entire US. Is there like a 101 course that people can take so that they're prepared for outreach events, whether that is local or international. So, you know, they're not shocked when they arrive at the scene and they're more prepared for the kind of events that they may encounter. They are more prepared as to what they need to do, what they need to bring, et cetera. Is there that kind of material or course, preparatory course that, you know, our volunteers and providers can join?
Sure, I think this question, I do have two experts to give the answer. One is Stephen Wong, another one is T.C. So, Stephen, would you like to answer this question?
Yeah, sure. Yes, we do have a training course. We are working on it, like giving to New York every year, have a retreat, follow some step to build the team first, then how understand the format of the SOP and line to line, because we train, we give out the mindset why you doing why you have to do medical outreach. Make sure everyone have the same in line. Then we have a training of what's the procedure, how to organize the outreach, how to do how to fill the form, how to enter the computer system. All those things we have it in menu. Actually, we are updating our SOP 2.0. We are on the review proofreading right now. from the first version, and unfortunately we are unable to finish by on time this time. It's about 250 pages around that pages compared to used to be 199 because we added on the follow-up care. Because we do follow-up care, we have to teach all the team how to do follow-up care. And we give step-by-step what needs to be done on follow-up care, all those things. So we do have it. But at this moment, we offer, Medical Foundation do offer any chapter as a like regional, regional can be invite Medical Foundation come over and do all this 2-day course or 3-day course to have train all the core team to understand how to do it. Even though that way, when we give it to you, the SOP, you guys can refer after you go through all this training and understand why we do this and why we have to fill this form. Because the reason we fill certain way of those forms to protect us, it's not because to give extra work, it's to protect us. And also, we also promoting all using the electronic charting, the way we collect data so that we can always pull it out for the doctors or anything when they need it. So we do have it. So we just need to see what other region that need start building their team, and we will be there to help you. Thank you.
Thank you, Steven. Steven is expert on the training, and we do have SOP in plan and keep updating it. And he also visited New York, Las Vegas, or some other branches to give teachings. If any regional office or branch office are willing to invite him and also his team work to go there to do training, I think everyone are welcome. And TC, you are expert on international medical training. So would you like to give some answer on this?
This topic is raising up last year, and to have a standard protocol that's all over different regions, much have a lot of desirable effect that make us more effectively and uniform, much easier to function with different groups work together. In terms of international, we want to train the local volunteer, get them involved, and get many of the way of practice to communicate through this training, so that's more efficient. We've been trying to do this for the last of the year, but slowly we try to get things more standardized. And both for the, there's a need for the local professionals, and we haven't know how to approach that yet, because there's so many issues that are pretty tricky, and we really need to communicate with them. And so we will be able to deal with the polypharmacy and also follow-up issue and a lot of different concept issue, and to make our work more efficient. But my main focus is on the training of non-medical personnel, so they can support the work of TIMA in the local. So this has been done in several countries, and we have, from our experience, and we're trying to push this and more standardized all over the places and make it easier to function.
Thank you, TC. I think another suggestion is for orientation before we go to international medical mission.
Yes, sir.
So
yes,
maybe
sir.
We can give a webinar before to give the participant orientation.
Yes, sir. Okay, that is a big issue before, because many people come to work with Suji. Honestly, if you are not Suji member, you all of a sudden work with Suji group. That's a cultural shock. Many people is not a, you know, they are a veteran in the medical mission, but when you go with other group and go with Suji, big difference, right? So that's, we want to put the expectation aligned together, and how do we work together. So we've been doing that, but I think that's not enough, because we can only do that in our region. And with this, if we put things on a webinar, and a large group of people can able to do that all over the country together, I think it's much more efficient. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, TC. Do we have time for last question? Okay. Kevin, sure. We can accept one or two last questions.
Sounds good. I think we may be able to answer both of these, actually. This particular one is quite interesting, and I think it applies to a lot of people. So when they come over from different countries, for example, they could be licensed in their own country, but not necessarily in the United States. And their providers, their professionals, could be nurse practitioners, etc. How can they participate in TIMA missions or international missions or even local outreaches and still be able to apply their skills, even though they may not have a license here? I guess some, a lot of people are probably asking the same question. So please let us all know how they can still contribute to the fullest.
Dr. Deng, would you like to add a few words on this?
I will divide this question up into within the U.S. and internationally. Within the U.S., unfortunately, if you don't have a license, you cannot practice in the United States. Now, when we do the international missions, this type of regulation is a bit loose. Quite often, with a good intention, often we can get supports from the local government, and we try to get documentations from the local government, and therefore we rarely, I don't remember encountering any legal issues that way. So internationally, by all means, it will be a lot easier. Within the United States, the answer will have to be a no. You need to be licensed in the United States.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Deng. Dr. Cheng?
Yeah. I want to echo what Dr. Stephen Tang said. He's absolutely right. In the United States, no matter who you are, even I had a legal license in California, if I go to New Orleans to do the medical outreach, I'm not allowed to touch patients unless during the about 2007, when they get the New Orleans disaster. So the government opened up the for five states to see that you can, as long as legal license of the whole United States, you allowed to practice there because the state of Louisiana to take all the liability. So don't let anyone who had the illegal or invalid the legal document to touch your patient. Nobody will outreach it. For the international, we had to get the reciprocity approval by the local government. I did not know in Mexico, we get that or not, I do not know. I know when in Haiti, I do so many outreach, we are not allowed to touch a patient because we are not exempted. And in Malaysia, Philippines, because I can do, I do a lot of surgery there, and because we get exempted by the local government. So that you had to find out first whether you can do something or not. And in every country had a little bit different situation. But in the United States, absolutely no.
Great, thank you. So we're running short on time. Maybe quickly on the very last question. In terms of, you know, we looked at a whole bunch of presentations the last couple of days. We have a lot of experts that are not necessarily doctors or dentists, but, you know, PhDs and experts in their own rights. So in terms of those, do we have a research component in terms of, you know, other professionals or experts or people doing fellowships who would like to, you know, provide some sort of evidence-based approach to, you know, plant-based diet, recovery to hospitalization, different aspects? Can we support that within the TIMA scope?
In short answer, we don't have this mechanism in TIMA right now in the United States. So no, but in the future, we may discuss whether there is any potential possibility for us to support. I think time is up. Thank you. And thank you all the participants. Thank you, Dr. Chen, Dr. Deng, TC, and Stephen Deng.
Thank you very much to our panelists. Thank you, Dr. K. Thank you, Stevens, and everybody else, Dr. Deng, Dr. Chen, TC. Great to see everybody here answering a lot of questions. We still have some questions that will remain unanswered, but not to worry. There are a lot of other announcements and answers that will be coming, whether that is on our website or through other methods. So that's the one more reason why make sure please subscribe to us on our Facebook page, follow us, like us, and that way you will find more and more answers to some of the questions that you may or may not yet think about.